Good morning, students. So we have to get used to this mode of delivery for the time being. So I will be recording this video and sharing this with you. We will announce some modus of conducting question and answer based on the topics that we have taught, and this will be informing you later. So today we will continue our discussion on recurrent neural network. We have already discussed about recurrent neural network previously. So this is a picture of a standard configuration of an RNN, where we have input at a time step T and an output at every time step T and one layer of hidden units. So this network has three sets of parameters: input to hidden, which is given by the vector U, hidden to hidden, given by the vector W, and hidden to output, given by the vector V. These are shared between all the time steps. Now, O is the output and Y is the desired output. So if we have a classification problem where at every time step we have a specific class as output, then the loss is obtained by taking Y hat as the softmax over this output, and based on the difference of Y hat and Y at a particular time step, the loss at that time step is computed. Now, since we have output at every time step, the total loss may be considered to be the sum or average of the losses at different time steps. And if we are dealing with cross entropy loss, then we can take LT as the negative log likelihood of YT given all the input up to that time step, which is given by the expression that we have shown here. Now, in a recurrent neural network, in order to be able to use backpropagation, the network has to be unfolded over time so that we can get a directed acyclic graph. And when we unfold this network, we can do backpropagation over that network, we can think of this as backpropagation through time. Now, we can also, so this backpropagation, when we are looking at a recurrent neural network, there are two types of depth which are involved. The first is, if we have multiple hidden layers, and then the feed forward depth is the longest depth or longest path between the input and the output at the same time step. For example, if you consider this particular configuration of a recurrent neural network where we have the input and three layers of hidden node, and this is the output, we can take the feed forward depth to be equal to 4. On the other hand, we can look at the recurrent depth, which is defined to be the longest path between the same hidden state in successive time steps. And therefore, if the sequence is of length T, then the recurrent depth is of size T. In this case, we have a sequence of length 3, and the recurrent depth is equal to 3. Now, when we do backpropagation through time, let us consider how the parameter W changes when we backpropagate through such a network. So when we see how W changes, we have to look at all the paths, because the change in W is based on del L by del W, the partial derivative of the loss function with respect to W. So we have to look at all the paths from the loss function L that traverse through W. Now, if we look at a particular, we saw that the loss function has several components, one at each time step. If we look at the loss function, let us say at time step 2, that is L2, and if we look at the path that it follows to the inputs x0, x1, x2, we see that the paths traversed as two instances of W. Similarly, if we look at L3, the path that the backpropagation traverses goes through three instances of W. Now, so the gradient has two summations, one for each of these losses, Lj, and for each Lj, it traverses through a number of edges which contain W, and this is over HK. So we can see that backpropagation has two summations. The first summation is over L, corresponding to the different loss functions. And the second summation is over H, because as we saw, each LJ depends on the weight matrices before it. Now, this is the same W which is getting affected. Now, the full backpropagation equation, we can write del L by del WH as this expression, where there are two summations, one corresponding to the different loss functions, J equal to 0 to capital T minus 1, and the other for one particular loss function, it goes through the different HIs through which it propagates, HKs through which this is propagated. So this is the final backpropagation equation. And if you look at the term here, we see that there is a product over del HM given del HM minus 1, all of which is affected by this wet matrix W. Now, if the sequence is very large, it may not be practical to do the backpropagation over the entire sequence. Therefore, to reduce the memory requirement, we often will be required to truncate the network. That is, instead of unfolding the network up to time step 0, we only unfold it up to a particular sequence length. For example, this truncation may run from J minus P up to J for some P, where P is the length of the sequence that we consider. When we do it like this, this is called truncated backpropagation through time, and this is what is usually done in practical situations. Now, though theoretically recurrent neural network is able to look at inputs which are far away in time, in practice the magnitude of the gradients may get degraded as we backpropagate through many layers. So long-term dependencies, though it is theoretically possible to capture, it is practically, or the long-term dependencies, it's not easy to capture using an RNN. Now the other thing to look at it is, because we are backpropagating through multiple instances of these parameters, if the initial weights are small, the gradients may shrink exponentially. If the gradient is less than 1, as we are taking the product of these gradients, the gradients will shrink exponentially. On the other hand, if the weights are big or the gradient is big, the gradient will grow exponentially. And RNNs have difficulty to deal with long-range dependencies. And presently, we will see variations of RNN which are able to capture this. But first, we will discuss about the complexity of this mechanism of backpropagation or backpropagation through time. We see that the computing the gradient of the loss function with respect to parameters is expensive, because it involves performing a forward propagation pass followed by a backward propagation through the graph. The forward propagation is because we give the input at different time steps, and the input is propagated through the feed forward depth and the recurrent depth in order to reach the output. And similarly, backpropagation, when we do it, it has to traverse the same paths in order to reach the input. So the runtime is O tau, where tau depends on the feed forward depth as well as the recurrent depth. And this runtime, it cannot be reduced by parallelization, because of the sequential nature of the function. So, and also the states which are computed during the forward pass must be stored until they are used in the backward pass. So memory cost is also order of tau. So though recurrent neural networks with hidden unit recurrence is very powerful, but they are also expensive to train. Now there are various strategies which are available to address the issue of vanishing and exploding gradients. So out of that, one of the methods is by careful use of weight initialization, there are multiple methods. One such method is identity RNN. The other is modifying the structure of a unit by having a constant error carousel. And this sort of gated structure, there are several gated variations of RNN which have been proposed, such as LSTM, GRU, etc. There are other methods such as Hessian free optimization and eco-state networks, which we will not talk about. Now, first we'll very briefly talk about weight initialization using identity RNN. So this is a basic RNN which uses ReLU as the nonlinear function, and it initializes the hidden to hidden matrix as an identity matrix. And the RNN is composed of rectified linear units. They are relatively easier to train and are good at modeling long-term dependencies. So by a combination of weight initialization by identity matrix and using ReLU unit, the effects of gradient diffusion can be handled to a certain extent. By far, one of the most popular methods of handling such phenomena is by using long short-term memory and other gated RNNs. Now, these gated RNNs are useful for their abilities to prevent gradients from vanishing or exploding, and they are usually the most popular method of working with RNN. So, the long short-term memory network, or in short LSTM, is a special kind of RNN which is capable of learning long-term dependencies. Even though they were introduced much earlier in 1997 by Hochreiter and Schmidhuber, they became popular only a few years ago. LSTMs operate using a series of gates, and these gates, we will see that they control what information is still relevant to the network. So even though an RNN state captures information about the input at all time steps preceding it, the RNN has to be trained, or LSTM has to be trained, so that the important information is retained and there is no loss in retaining this type of information. So before we see how an LSTM looks like, first let us recapitulate the basic RNN. So basic RNN has this sort of chain-like structure. These are the inputs at different time steps, XT minus 1, XT and XT plus 1. And these are the hidden units at these time steps. And each unit has a nonlinear function such as tan H or sigmoid. So this is a standard RNN containing a single layer. On the other hand, a long short-term memory on LSTM, its unit, the hidden unit or the repeating module, it contains four interacting layers. And we will discuss this in detail. So before we look into the what, you know, this has four gates, and we will look at what each gate performs. This yellow, we'll just say that the notation, these yellow boxes are the neural units. These pink boxes show the pointwise operation. These arrows show vectors which are transferred. These arrows which come together, you know, they mean concatenation. So this arrow and this arrow, they are coming together. This means concatenation. And when they are going out, they means copy. The same output is copied here and here. Now, with this, we will look at what these gates are and how they function. The basic idea behind LSTM is that we have this horizontal layer, which we call the cell state, the cell state CT. It acts like a conveyor belt. Now, this state runs through the entire chain of the sequence with some linear interactions. There is no non-linearity on this cell state which affects the cell state. And therefore, the way we change the cell state is within our control. There is no degradation due to use of sigmoid or other units, because the interactions to cell T are all linear. and information can easily flow along this unchanged if we so desire. And as we will see, the different gates control how information can be removed or added to the cell state, and this is regulated by gates. And this is a structure of a gate, which is, this is a particular, let us say, a sigmoid gate, sigmoid network, which gives an output, and this output interacts with this cell state via multiplication or addition. So if it interacts with multiplication, the value at this line, it is multiplied with the value output by this. Now, gates are a way to let information through, and we have three gates that protect and control the cell state. So these gates consist of, as we said, a sigmoid unit and a multiplication operation. As we know, as you know, that the sigmoid outputs a value which is in most states either close to 0 or close to 1, and in a small case it is a linear. 0 means nothing is let through, and 1 means everything is let through. Now let us look at each of the gates. So as we go through this LSTM step by step. In step 1, we have the forget gate. This gate decides what information from the previous state we are going to throw away from the cell state. This decision is made by the forget gate. The forget gate takes as input the current input XT and the previous H, HT minus 1. So based on XT and HT minus 1, by concatenation of these two, there is this neural unit which computes and decides how much of the previous information to forget. So FT is sigmoid of, this is the parameters WF corresponding to this gate, and the input is a concatenation of HT minus 1 and XT, and BF is the bias value. So this is to decide how much we forget. If FT is close to 1, you forget most of the information. If FT is close to 0, you retain most of the information. Now, to get an intuition of why this would be useful, let us take an example from NLP. In natural language processing, in a language model, we use a language model to predict the next word based on the previous ones. Now, suppose the cell state contains information about the gender of the present subject so that the proper pronouns can be used. Now, when we see a new subject, we may forget the old subject because now we are interested to retain the gender of the new subject. So in this case, we might like to forget the previous information. Now, the next gate that we will look at is the input gate. So input gate decides what new information we are going to store in the cell state. So as we have seen that the forget gate tells how much of the old information to forget, the input gate decides what is the new information that should be put. So this input gate has two parts. There is a sigmoid layer called the input gate layer. This decides which values we will update. And then our tanH layer creates a vector of new candidate values that could be added to the state. So IT is obtained by using the sigmoid function on, again, based on XT and HT minus 1, is the set of parameters WI, and based on it we decide which values or which lines, which bits need to be updated. And CT bar, which is obtained by this tanH function, this tanH also works on this concatenation of HT minus 1 and XT using the parameters WC. So this outputs the value by which they will be updated. Now, we can take IT multiplied by CT prime to update those values. So before we look into it, let us look at an example where this may be useful. In the same example of the language model where we wish to predict the next word, suppose we now want to add the gender of the new subject in the cell state to replace the old one we are forgetting. So this IT will tell which is the bit corresponding to gender or wherever this information is stored, which value has to be updated, and CT bar finds the value by which it would be updated so that it reflects the gender of the new subject. Now, once we have computed IT and CT tilde, then the CT, that the cell state, is updated by adding IT into CT tilde to this state. So we have earlier seen that the forget gate, through the forget gate, we identify FT, how much of this to forget. So the CT becomes the earlier value of CT, that is CT minus 1 into FT. And IT into CT tilde tells you what to be added. So to CT, we add IT into CT tilde. So we can say CT equal to FT into CT, CT that is the previous CT, plus IT into CT tilde. So this is how the cell state is updated from one time step to the next time step. Now again, coming to the example of the language model, this is where we would actually drop the information about the old subject's gender through FT into CT and add information about the new subject gender through IT into CT tilde. And this is how the cell state is updated. Finally, you know, so this is how the cell state is updated and it flows to the next time step. Finally, we have to decide how to give the output OT at this time step. Now this output, if you have an output at this time step, the output will be based on the cell state, but it will be a filtered version. So first we can run a sigmoid layer which decides what part of the cell state we are going to output. Then we put the cell state through tanH to push values to be between minus 1 and 1. So this is the sigmoid layer which decides which part of the cell state to output. Then this cell state is put through the tanH layer and we multiply it by the output of the sigmoid gate so that only this part that we want to output is output. So OT is sigmoid of WO the corresponding parameters of this sigmoid gate. Again, the input is HT minus 1 concatenated with XT. So sigmoid over this gives us OT. And the output HT is this OT into tanH of CT. So this CT is moved from minus 1 to 1 and this is taken as the output of this gate. So if you again take the example of the language model, if you saw a subject, it might want to output information relevant to a word, something with respect to this output. So this part, what part of it to be output, is selected by this sigmoid gate, and based on that, that portion of CT is output as HT. So just to recapitulate, this LSTM we have seen comprises of these gates. The first is the forget gate, which tells which part of the old information to remove. The input gate decides how that has to be updated, which comprises of two parts. One which decides which part of the input to be updated, and the second part to decide how it is to be updated. And then this forget gate and the out, input get, they affect the cell state in this following manner. Ct equal to ft into ct plus it into ct tilde. Now each of these gates is computed by taking a sigmoid or a tanh and takes as input ht minus 1 and xt. Finally, the output of the gate ht is obtained by first deciding which part of the cell line has to be output, and then the value of the cell line passed through a tanh function is multiplied with the value of the output to decide the output ht. Now this is about an LSTM. Now there are different variations of LSTM. For example, the gated recurrent unit GRU was used by the people in NLP, which is also a gated unit which comprises three instead of four gates. So it combines the forget and input into a single update gate. So it has one update gate. It also merges the cell state and hidden state. There is no separate hidden state, and some other changes are there. This gate has a smaller number of units, but it has similar functionality as is done in an LSTM. There are also different variations of LSTM, such as pipole LSTM and also GRU, but we will not discuss those details here. So what we wish to understand, that such units like LSTM or GRU help us to retain long distance information which we think are useful to retain, because the cell state in an LSTM passes through a channel, through this conveyor belt, where there is no loss in information. So, and we can control exactly what information we can put and what information we can forget. This allows us to retain useful information from long distance. Now, with this, we will complete the first part of today's class. And because of this mode of teaching, I will take questions from you offline. So we will try to arrange a sort of discussion either through a forum, or if we can arrange some online live session at the time where we can take questions. Okay. Now with this gap, I will now start the second part of today's class, where we will show an example of use of an RNN in neural machine translation. Now, in a machine translation is one of the most important tasks of natural language processing. So it comprises of taking a sentence belonging to a language L1 as input and outputting the corresponding sentence in a different language L2. So you note that the words in L1 and the words in L2, the corresponding words in the sentence of L2, they usually do not correspond to each other. Also, the lengths of the sentence in L1 and the length of the sentence in L2 may be different. Now, the standard model which was used for machine translation, the neural-based machine translation, again, machine translation has gone through several phases. In the first phase, there was rule-based machine translation, which was not very successful. Then people have worked on statistical machine translation based on conventional machine learning using the noisy channel model. And then came neural machine translation. In the last couple of years, neural machine translation has become so successful that starting from late 2016, from 2017 onwards, the success story of neural machine translation has grown, and now most standard methods for machine translation follow this approach. Now the basic neural machine translation system comprises of two parts, the encoder and the decoder. So encoder is this part which takes the sentence in the source language as input, and it may use an RNN. And after it has looked at the entire sentence, it encodes the sentence in the state vector. And from that context vector, one can now output the sentence in the target language, and this part is called the decoder. Now this is a diagram of the encoder decoder model of machine translation. So this is the encoder which takes the sentence as input. Suppose we have this English sentence, economic growth has slowed down in recent years. So this is the, these are the words that we are giving as input to the encoder. So we give, we can use a one hot encoding as the initial input which is fed to this encoder. So this shows a vector having V size, where V corresponds to the number of words in our vocabulary, and each of the inputs corresponds to, suppose economic corresponds to the second word, growth corresponds to the fifth word, he has to the seventh word, and the corresponding bit is 1 and the rest is 0. This is the one hot encoding which is used as the initial input. And then we have a vector representation of the words. In the earlier class, we have talked about one of the methods of representing word embeddings through word-to-vec, such as SIBAO or SKIPGRAM. So we can use such continuous representations corresponding for each word, and this is the input which is fed to my recurrent neural network. So this is the word economic, this is its corresponding word vector, this is the word growth and its word vector, the word has and its word vector, and so on. And then we have a recurrent neural network such as an LSTM, and which takes this sequence. Now this encoder takes this sequence, and at the end of processing the sequence, this is the last state of the hidden unit. So this is the encoder in larger size. So this is the word, this is a word, and this is its one hot encoding. Then from the one hot encoding, we do a lookup to take the word vector of that word, and then from the current state of HT and the word vector input in the next state, we compute HT plus 1 in the RNN. And finally, after we have looked at the entire sentence, the last state of the H of the hidden unit, it represents all the information about this input sentence. Now this representation of the input sentence is fed to the decoder. The decoder has to output the sentence in the target language. Now this is the context vector output by the decoder, in this output by the encoder. So in this picture, this context vector is fed to all the time steps, the recurrent states of the entire, all the decoder states. Now, if you look at, you know, the first decoder state, we have this hidden unit ZI, and it outputs a score for each possible word in the vocabulary, which can be normalized to get the probability for each word. And from the, given the probability of each word, one can generate a particular word as the output. Now, once that word is generated in the output, the next hidden state takes as input the previous generated word. The hidden Z at the previous time step, and also the context vector. And from given this current value of H, it generates the probability of each word, and from the probability of each word, the decoder generates a particular word. So this is the encoder-decoder model for machine translation, or sequence-to-sequence machine translation. Now, this model, we can make some modifications. First of all, as I told you, we can use LSTM instead of a vanilla RNN, and it usually gives rise to better results. Secondly, we can add depth to the model. Instead of having one hidden layer, we can have multiple hidden layers. Also, as we have seen earlier, we instead of having a single directional RNN, we can have a bidirectional RNN or LSTM. And finally, so we said that from these probabilities, we generate the word in the output. We can generate the word with the highest probability as the output, or we can sample from the words, few words with higher probability, or one can use some sort of beam search. In beam search, what we do is that if the beam size is B at every time step, we choose the B highest probability words. And then from that, we use a beam decoder, beam search based decoder, to output the next sentence. Those details we will not talk about today. However, what we will be doing in the subsequent classes, we will see what is the problem with the RNN model of or LSTM model of machine translation and how we can use attention to improve this. So this table shows that shows how these LSTM and attention, etc., how they fared on machine translation on French English. So there was a basic model by Badanau, which gave a Bloy score, is a method of evaluating machine translation. So, you know, this is a baseline model having 28.45 as the Bloy score. And then using a single forward LSTM with a beam size of 12, one could get a Bloy score of 26.17. Single reversed LSTM beam size of 12, give a Bloy score of 30.5. If you use ensemble of 5 reversed LSTM beam size 1, gives you 33 Bloy score. Ensemble of 2 reversed LSTM beam size 12 gives 33. Ensemble of 5 reversed LSTM beam size 2 gives 34.5. And ensemble of 5 reversed LSTM beam size 12 gives 34.81. So it has been found that even without using bidirectional LSTM, if we feed the input sentence in reverse order, the output is improved. We also see that use of LSTM improves machine translation, and higher beam size is also helpful. We will look at later what is Badanau's method and how it works. Now, one of the criticisms of the sequence-to-sequence model of the unidirectional machine translation encoder-decoder based machine translation system is that the encoder looks at the entire sentence and captures it in a fixed length vector. And no matter how big the sentence is, all information is captured by a fixed length vector, and therefore there may be a lot of loss in information. In the next class, we will see how the attention model addresses this. So I will stop here today. I will request you to go through this video and through the slides, and if you have questions, make a note of this, and we will very soon tell you how you can ask the questions online, and if possible, either we will address these questions through text, or we will come up with a live session where we can answer to your question. Thank you. All of you have a very good time.